Welcome to another edition of County Connection. I'm your host, Berks County Commissioner Christian Leinbach, and today we have an exciting topic. We're going to talk about the restoration of passenger rail service for the City of Reading and Berks County. My guest on today's show is Tom Frawley, and Tom Frawley is the Executive Director of the Schuylkill River Passenger Rail Authority. Tom, great to have you on the show today. We have a great topic to talk about.
Happy to be here. Looking forward to it.
There's been a lot said, especially in recent weeks, about the restoration of passenger rail service. But there's a little bit more to the story. There's some history behind this, and we're going to take a look at that in just a second. But it has two components. One is that we lost passenger rail service in the City of Reading and Berks County in 1981. But there's a lot more to that. So let's take a minute and look at some of the key points. And we can go back and forth, but the Reading and Philadelphia Railroad was founded April 4th, 1933, and it was primarily about hauling coal between Pottsville, Reading, and Philadelphia. How many years ago was that? You just told me.
190 years ago.
That's pretty incredible, isn't it?
That's quite a history.
And it's almost 43 years that we've been without the passenger rail service, but it started out as freight, and currently a good portion, not all of it, the line that we're talking about between here and Norristown is Norfolk Southern. But Norfolk Southern actually goes to Philadelphia, and we can talk a little bit about that. But give us a little bit more information as we look at the slide here, some of the other details from the history.
Sure. Well, as some people might be familiar, freight and passenger rail both were heavily used during the Second World War, peaks in a lot of ways. And after the war, the increased use of the automobile led to a decline in passenger rail. And by the time we got to the 1960s, service to Reading was limited to commuter rail only, meaning mornings and evenings on weekdays. And SEPTA assumed responsibility in 1976, and as you mentioned, by 1981, they had given it up.
And I've learned a lot of people are simply not aware that this was a SEPTA commuter rail operation when it ceased operations.
It was, and Berks County is not part of the coalitions of counties that represent SEPTA, but that was because when SEPTA assumed responsibility for passenger rail operations from Conrail, that was part of the operating contract at the time to serve Reading.
And so that service was suspended in 1981. Then what?
Well, the day after it stopped, people were starting to raise the questions of, well, how can we get it started again? And there have been a number of studies over the years, some more elaborate than others. Unfortunately, none of them ever led to success, but I think we're facing a different set of circumstances this time.
I think you're right. And when you look at the two, I would say, most notorious studies, one was the light rail, the Schuylkill River Metro project. That was looked at through a good part of the 90s. That ended up with a preliminary price tag of $2 billion. The other one came, the study finished up, I'm going to say 2009, maybe 2010. And I remember that. I was in office, and the primary means of raising money to build the line out was tolling Route 422, and that went over like a lead balloon with Montgomery, Chester, and Berks County. The study never saw the light of day, but this has been different. So let's talk about what has happened in the more recent years and what brings us to this program today.
Well, a couple of things. In 2020, actually, the Berks Alliance undertook a private sector sponsored study. So there's no public money, and they said, "Well, what can we do differently?" And a very powerful conclusion. Say, well, why don't we look at this as intercity rail as opposed to commuter rail? More efficient.
That was the first time somebody looked at it that way.
Exactly. It had. I mean, I guess when it was initially started in the 1800s, you could have characterized it as intercity, but
that's
it hadn't
true.
Been that way in a very, very long time.
Well, and all of the studies focused on restoration of commuter.
Positively, even the state Department of Transportation state rail plan characterized it as commuter rail. But this study took a different approach, looking at it as intercity rail. And based on the response to that and the potential expressed in that study, the three counties, Berks, Montgomery, and Chester, formed a committee.
Mm-hmm.
That was 2021. And
I think, let me touch
certainly.
On that, because there was two things that I saw happen. One, the Berks Alliance realizing that Phoenixville was also working on a study separately.
Yes.
Got together with Phoenixville, and they began to realize we might be more effective if we could somehow bring our projects together.
Indeed.
I was brought into this very early on by Berks Alliance, and I was intrigued, to say the least, by their study because I recognized some of the fundamental differences. Private sector, first one ever,
right.
Funded private sector, and looking at Amtrak. And I actually reached out in 2020 to colleagues in Chester County and Montgomery County and asked, would you be interested in the formation of a committee? And ultimately that led to the creation, as you noted, of the Tri-County Area Passenger Rail Committee.
Right, right. And the operation as a committee continued for a year. And a lot of progress was made, and I think the key was when the bipartisan infrastructure law passed, and
October of 2021.
Exactly, yep. And this created the federal program for development of passenger rail service using a standardized model across the country. Instead of everybody kind of doing their own thing, the idea was let's create a template. And it'll be more efficient for everybody to go through that same process.
And there were several things. That was one. The second thing that the infrastructure bill accomplished is it designated money to do the work. One of the huge problems with every other study is where do you get the money? The 422 tolling
right.
was about where do you get the money. Here, that money was designated, but there was a third very important component. Up until that time, there was somewhat of a debate among our authority members, is this a commuter or is this inner city? When the bipartisan infrastructure bill passed, we were literally contacted by PennDOT, SEPTA, saying, hey, you gotta go with Amtrak.
Right.
This is a game changer. And that caused us to say, okay, we need to move that direction. During 2021, we were working with Kozloff Stout, Dan Becker, mm-hmm. attorney, and working on documents to form an authority. That happened. Tell us a little bit about that in April of 2022.
Well, the authority took shape, as you mentioned, in early 2022. And one of the first orders of business was to respond to a notice from the federal government mm-hmm. to, if you want to participate in this program, we'd like you to submit a letter of interest. And so
this is the CID program.
The Corridor Identification and Development Program, which is mm-hmm. run by the Federal Railroad Administration. And that was, I guess, the first formal action.
The first formal action was, I believe, apart from organizing our board, was hiring an executive director.
Okay.
You may have missed that point.
Okay.
Because you played a major role once we brought you on board. And you weren't the only choice. There were several applicants, came down to two finalists. I fully support the decision we made. You've been a great asset. You have years of experience behind you. And those years have benefited us greatly. And the Corridor ID program then was the next right, big action after hiring you.
I appreciate you saying years and not decades, but
well, we're almost the same age, so I don't want to make you look too old. Otherwise, I'm impeding
myself. Dating ourselves, yeah. But no, I appreciate that, and this is one that's close to my heart. As you may recall, I was the primary author of the Phoenixville study. I live in Chester County, so the project is literally in my backyard, and so it's one that I have a personal connection with beyond my my professional work.
So this was a long process, though, and before you go through the process, we realized that if we were going to have any serious shot at success, we really needed to win the FRA Carter ID program this round.
True.
There's no doubt that there will be future rounds, but what we don't know is the money. Okay. The money for this has already been allocated in the bipartisan infrastructure bill.
Yes.
And I said to people that if we didn't win this, I felt that would add years to the process and make everything more difficult. So we applied in March of 2022. Excuse me. We were told, I think, initially... 23, you're right. 23. We were told initially we should have an answer in May. That quickly changed to September. That then changed to November. And just talk a little bit about...
We did finally hear by December 8th.
But, we did.
Which wasn't too far off. But, well, we had prepared an application, and the nature of the application was pretty strictly defined in the federal materials, which we found encouraging, because at least this way we knew the metrics that we were going to be scaled against or scored against. And in a lot of ways, we have some very, very strong characteristics in our favor, which I think weighed heavily in the ultimate decision. We're starting with a piece of railroad that's in excellent condition. Norfolk Southern maintains a super high quality piece of railroad there. That, in terms of maintenance condition, would accommodate 80 mile an hour passenger trains today. You know, some of these projects around the country are, you know, they're talking about trying to restore service to some streak of rust in the woods.
Where they don't even have a right-of-way yet.
Yeah, don't even have anything to work with. So we're very fortunate in terms of a starting point there. We also are deserving in a lot of ways because of the nature of the three communities served. We have a lot of very high percentages of people below the poverty line, a lot of very high percentages of people, households that do not have an automobile. So access to rail transportation would be a tremendous boost to those communities, and not a silver bullet, certainly, but a key component in the economic revival of those communities.
Without a doubt. And the city of Reading is the fourth largest city in the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. And you look at the other cities, some cases smaller. Lancaster City has Amtrak. Dauphin County has Amtrak. Erie has rail service. I believe it's Amtrak.
I'm not 100%
sure. So you look at Reading, it is a critical step. Now, we did something before we knew that we won the CIDP program to take us to the next step. We recognized that in order to implement that phase one, two, and three, we needed a partner. And so you led the effort with the authority, putting together an RFP for services for this. So we had that ready to go and ready to vote when we had the answer. So we got the call on December, the 8th is when it was
official.
Official. As you and I know, a couple days before that, everything was blowing up. Some congressional leaders, actually in another part of the country, got information from FRA that was supposed to be embargoed until Friday, but they didn't.
Yes.
And once one congressional individual released the information. It just started to get it.
The horse was out of the barn.
Everywhere. And you and I talked and said, you know, our partners, the FRA, the Federal Rail Administration, right. ask them whether they want us to say anything now or wait till Friday. They said, wait till Friday. We did. Yeah. That was the right thing to do.
Positively.
But we were able to celebrate that. And then at our very next meeting, we were able to vote on the consultant. Explain what the consultant is going to do before we go into the next steps.
There'll be both CIDP steps one and two, which we'll explain that in a minute.
And CIDP, corridor ID program for the Federal Rail Administration.
Exactly, exactly. And they will be doing a scoping exercise for preparing a service development plan. So this is to finalize a statement of work, a budget, and a schedule, and also a project management plan, which would describe how various functions would take place, everything from communication to lines of authority and responsibility. So that'll be the first step. And then in the second step, they will actually prepare the service development plan. And a service development plan is simultaneously a business plan, an operating plan, a management plan. It's a lot of different things, but it will include everything from defining the purpose and need to operating analyses, which will drive the identification of what infrastructure improvements need to be made, to operating schedules and things of that nature.
So let's one thing I want to share before we get into the details on the CIDP program. What our organization structure looks like. We referred to the authority board already, referenced your hiring, but here's the structure. So the board is made up of 9 appointed individuals. If you look at this list all the way to the viewer's left, that's Montgomery County. Ken Lawrence, a former commissioner, did not run for re-election, and Montgomery County commissioners will be appointing someone to fill that. Mayor Stephanie Henrich is the mayor of Pottstown, and Scott France is the Montgomery County planner. Those individuals are appointed exclusively by Montgomery County. The 3 in the middle are for Berks County, myself, and I also act as the chair of the authority. Mayor Eddie Moran, mayor of the city of Reading, is a member. And then the newest member is David Hunter. And David Hunter is also our meeting, our planning director. And then Chester County is Commissioner Marion Moskowitz, Mayor Pete Urschler, he's the mayor of Phoenixville, and Brian O'Leary, also head of the Chester County planning group. And then you're in the role of executive director, and you really work very closely with the county planners, our main consultant, Transportation for America, Virtual Farm, who does our social media content, and then AECOM, who is our new design consultant, and you work very closely with our legal counsel. We have about 9 minutes left, so take us through the next steps of the Federal Rail Administration. It includes 3 key steps. Talk to us about those steps.
Well, step one, as I mentioned, that's a scoping exercise. And our acceptance into the corridor program basically puts us into step one with a budget of up to $500,000. No matches required for that. Step two is the service development plan. I mentioned that earlier. And step three is the engineering and design, preliminary engineering and design, also often referred to as 30% design. The funding's a little different for steps two and three. Step two requires a 10% match, and step three requires a 20% match. So at the end of step three, you have completed preliminary design and then be looking to FRA to proceed into implementation, meaning final design and construction.
So take us through a little bit of detail on step one.
Certainly. I mentioned scoping. So when we say scoping, we're talking about The statement of work itself, the exact tasks that have to be accomplished, and the schedule and budget to do that. So we're scoping how we're going to prepare the service development plan. How long is it going to take? How much money do we have to spend to do that? What are the individual tasks within that? And then the project management plan, this talks to, as I mentioned, you know, what are the lines of responsibility? What are the reporting requirements? This is a federally funded program, so there are reporting requirements associated with the grant that must be adhered to. This step one, should probably be accomplished in something like 3 or 4 months once we actually get started, which should be very soon. We actually have our kickoff meeting tomorrow with the Federal Railroad Administration for the corridor program, and hopefully we'll be underway within a matter of a couple of weeks with our consultant.
And then a little bit of an overview for step two.
Step two, the service development plan itself, as I mentioned, it's a operating plan, it's a business plan. So it's everything from looking at alternatives between Bridgeport and Philadelphia. There are a couple of alternative routes, whether we stay on the west side of the Schuylkill River or go over to the east side of the river. They would have to be resolved. A lot of computer modeling, developing some little conceptual level engineering so we can do cost estimating. And not by any measure the least, some public outreach. So we want to make sure the public stays engaged and is aware of what we're doing.
And then in step three, which is a little bit further down the road, and we'll talk about that in just a second, that's when we get into a lot of the capital intensive areas.
This is more nuts and bolts work for sure. We're going to be actually doing design work for track, if necessary, tunnel work, certain aspects of stations. We can talk to the shared responsibility in that area. Signals. Also, a big piece of the step three is environmental. Under the National Environmental Protection Act, we have documentation that has to be prepared. Because it's an existing railroad, we're expecting a relatively simple process.
This is where it's very complicated if it's either at least not an operational railroad, or worse yet, if there are no right-of-ways.
A lot more has to be done. We're very fortunate in that regard. Doesn't mean we don't have to do anything. The categorical exclusion process isn't just a blank sheet. You know, what it is is there are other things. So everything from historic structures to air quality impacts, there are a variety of things that still must be addressed. It's just not as elaborate as a full-blown environmental impact statement.
So when we look at this, we're dealing with a phased approach. Talk to me a little bit about the phases, and we have an outline here, and we also have a map to kind of show people what we're talking about.
The three phases that we've identified here. Phase one is Reading to Philadelphia. This is the segment where, as you know, there is no service now. In the second phase, we would hope...
No passenger rail service.
I'm sorry, no passenger rail service, correct. It's an active freight railroad. We're looking at, you know, 4-6 round trips a day by rail. The bus doesn't go away. The bus would stay. There's two round trips a day by bus now, and they would complement the train service.
And I put the map up. The blue area is what we're talking about on phase one.
Correct.
From Reading, Pottstown, Phoenixville, Norristown, Philadelphia.
Correct, correct. And then once that's up and running, we would ultimately like to get to phase two, which is akin to the Keystone service that PennDOT sponsors, which is Harrisburg, Philadelphia, New York. And the idea is you get a one-seat ride from stations between Harrisburg and Philadelphia to go to destinations in New York.
This is one of the things that came out of the TEMS study that makes the project more financially sensible.
Right.
In the old models where you're just going back and forth between Philadelphia, your rolling stock spends more time sitting than running, and it adds a tremendous expense. Where here, you're literally taking a train from Reading to New York via Philadelphia. You can get off at any stop.
Sure.
But the train itself continues through to Moynihan Station. Now, there's a timing issue there.
There is. There's a major capital program, a set of improvements that are being undertaken in the New York metropolitan area, the keystone component of which is new tunnels under the Hudson River. When all those infrastructure improvements are made, you would be able to accommodate the additional one-seat ride all the way to New York. The issue there is, though, that's sort of in the 2035 time frame.
Yep, that is. So let's talk about time. We have just a little over 2 minutes left. Looking at the timeline, we have a chart here. We're right now on target to start the CIPD step one. You'll see that at the beginning of 2024. We plan at this point to move into step two here in 2024, probably not finish that till early 25, and then be in step three, 2025, possibly into 2026.
Yes.
One important note, and by June of 2025, all three counties will have to vote to reauthorize the authority for another 47 years. That was done on purpose, simply because we don't know what we don't know.
Yes.
And so probably this time next year, each of the counties will be setting up some public hearings, mm-hmm. and ultimately by June, mm-hmm. we'll vote to reauthorize. And I will make this point, if one county says no, it's dead.
Well, on your point about we didn't know what we didn't know, having completed the service development plan by that time, we would expect to have a pretty clear picture.
Exactly.
And hopefully people will be able to see exactly where the program's going at that point, as opposed to now that they view it perhaps a little more speculatively.
So looking at next steps, obviously the next step is finalizing the grant agreement with FRA. We have a meeting with them tomorrow, a virtual meeting.
Right.
Finalizing the consultant agreement, initiating step one. Those are immediate. We also probably in this calendar year will start working with Norfolk Southern and SEPTA, possibly CSX, depending on what area where we go in Norristown.
Mm-hmm.
But the big question that people ask is, when will we have passenger rail service? And you and I've talked about this. With the success we've seen, I am very optimistic that it's no longer a discussion of if, it's more a discussion of when. And I believe at this juncture that it is not unrealistic to look at 5 years from now, potentially by 2029. We could be looking at the restoration of passenger rail service. Pretty exciting times to be living
in. Very exciting times. And that's a perfectly reasonable estimate of the time that it would take to get that finished.
Well, thank you very much, Tom, for joining us. I want to thank you for watching another edition of County Connection. I hope you learned a lot more about the restoration of passenger rail service to Redding and Berks County. I'm your host, Berks County Commissioner Christian Leinbach, thanking you for joining us for another edition of County Connection.